Hi there, we're Shame and this is Records in My and Sean's Life.
Guys, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you very much for having us.
Thanks for having us.
Man. How are you? What's new?
Just having a jolly old time right now, enjoying the fruits of Canada.
Yeah.
Flew through an electrical storm on the way in, which was, for a hot minute, I thought it was like, this is going to be our, you know, Lynyrd Skynyrd almost famous moment. But then it was good. You know?
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about some records and some fun. So what records, what inspired you to start playing?
I think we all grew up... we were quite fortunate to have quite musical parents. None of them were musicians or anything like that, but they all had a great knowledge of music. And everyone grew up with quite different bands, but in similar genres. Like I was growing up with my mum loving the Beatles and Bob Dylan and Patti Smith, and my dad was more like Django Reinhardt and Elvis and Sinatra and Tony Bennett and stuff. And obviously me and Sean have been best mates since we were 8.
Wow.
So we kind of...
I was raised on Beck.
Yeah, we kind of...
Pretty cool.
Yeah, that was the first music I ever remember hearing.
Now I'm feeling old. You're raised on Beck. That's incredible. Yeah. That's another generation.
We were exposed to quite a lot of music together when we were kids, just on YouTube, like Stiff Little Fingers, because right. Sean's mum's Irish, who showed us them. And
I mean, my dad showed me Stiff Little
Fingers. Oh, did your dad show
He's from Leicester.
Them? All right, yeah. But when we came...
I'm trying to answer my facts, brother.
when we came together, it was... I think that was when we sort of found out about more... less sort of like the foundations of like guitar music or avant-garde music, and we sort of found more of the niche bands like The Fall and people like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Like cult bands.
I think a big moment for me was like hearing Television for the first time. That was pretty, you know, I was pretty content with being terrible at the guitar at that point. Not saying I still am not terrible at the guitar, but that was like, okay, this is like...
Definitely, that was like the aesthetic of it was generally something that was very appealing. I mean, I can't play an instrument. Like, I can strum a few guitar chords. And like, when I started, to those, the songs that made me want to do it was like English Rose by The Jam and Well Respected Man by The Kinks. But I think the simplicity of all of that is quite linked to when I first heard The Fall as well. And they've got a song called the NWRA, The North Arrives Again, on Grotesque album. And it's just so simple. And it's just sort of like one strumming and like a, you know, really simple bass line as well. That was really sort of like, that really appealed to me because it's, you know, it was almost like it was an extended pop song and it was able to form something completely unique.
So what record, you guys live in South London right now, or I know you're both in different places.
Well, we live in a van right now.
No, no shame in that. At least you have
right
a roof,
right? Right now
we're
living in Vancouver, British Columbia.
Yeah, exactly.
What's an album that reminds you of South London? Because there's a lot of history there and with music.
What?
I don't know. I think it's all quite
Squeeze.
Weird. Yeah, like Squeeze. There's a song called Up the Junction, which is my favourite Britpop song, but it wasn't written in the Britpop era. And that sort of tells the story of like...
Holland on the keys there.
Yeah, Jules Holland on the keys there. And it's a very British story and it's set in a place called Clapham Junction, which is very near where a lot of us live. I think that's sort of like... I think anything that sort of tells a really good and clear story is quite English.
That part of London as well is the kind of area no one talks about in any music you've ever heard. So it's like, oh my God, someone's talking about Clapham Junction in a song. Like, this is crazy.
This is good. This could be a breakthrough moment in the show.
That's a great song as well.
That's one of my favorite songs ever. And it's got one of the best lines. I'd beg for some forgiveness, but begging ain't my business.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
That's a pretty good one. I'm trying to start a record collection for my son. He's 3. He's totally into music. He's got great taste somehow.
That's awesome.
But what's a good record? Give me one each.
The first record I ever bought, the first vinyl, was Tom Waits' Asylum Years, and I got it from me and Sean's primary school fate for 10p.
That's incredible.
Which is like a cent of Canadian,
yes.
You know. And that's basically Tom Waits and it's got about 20 tracks on it, and it's when he was at Asylum Records. And it's like my favorite Tom Waits era, and I just used to listen to that again and again through my childhood, teenagehood, and like when I did all of my exams and stuff. But the first record I ever played on a record player was one that my dad gave me, which was Joe Jackson and the Jumpin' Jive.
Oh, nice.
Which still has some of my favorites. So I was listening to it.
Which one are you picking for the...
I was listening to it in the bath today.
I could hear you.
It was the song. That is the name of the album, I'm pretty sure. It's got the blue and yellow with him like going like that, and it's like the outline of a saxophone in the background. That's
he's
the name.
Wearing like a trench coat and like
he's wearing a suit with a skinny tie.
Okay,
I think that's the album.
I'd probably go, especially because it was one of the first albums I ever heard, I'd probably go Odelay by Beck. I think at that point when I was that young, my parents always used to play like the Beatles and everything like that. And honestly, like at that age, like I was so not into it. And that was the first music I remember liking when I was that age. So I'm gonna go for that one. A lot of bangers on that.
Hugely influential. You talked about The Jam before, and what's a good album? I mean, we're living obviously in unstable political times. What's a good like protest record?
I don't know. To be honest, I still think like Stiff Little Fingers have some of the greatest like anti-protest songs, and we were lucky enough to me and Sean had an evening with the bassist from the Stiff Little Fingers. We found out a lot of information that we weren't aware of about how much hardship they actually went through. You know, one of the original members was shot by an English policeman and killed, and there wasn't any live music allowed to be played, so they used to have to hop from squat to squat practicing, and people would just gather in the streets outside because they'd never heard live music before. So I think like Johnny Was or something like that was like...
Yeah, that's about Bloody Sunday.
Yeah, just like something like that. Like every time I hear that song, it's like they're a real band and they were amazing. And they're like, yeah.
I'd say like Rodriguez as well. Obviously that, you know, they did that Searching for Sugar Man documentary. And that was pretty amazing. That was like one of the soundtrack to the revolution against apartheid. You know, the songs like Can't Get Away and stuff.
Yeah.
When I'm feeling revolutionary, that's what I listen to. Yeah.
Let's talk about your record a little bit, and I mean the inspirations behind it and the title, where we can find it. It's fantastic. I love the record. I never say that to artists, but it's a do. It's always in my head.
Oh,
the tracks are
much.
Always like I was, you know, bopping around listening.
Well, thank
to
you
it.
Very much.
That's really kind of you to say. Where that record came from, it was kind of just sort of like the growth into adulthood. We started the band when I was 16, and like the rest of the guys were 17, and we were still in school. We were still working, and it was over the period of 3 years, so we ended up recording that album when we were 19 or 20.
In Wales,
yeah. So I think it's kind of like, it's about, you know, discovering what sort of like music we wanted to make, as well as like social observations about the surroundings we were in, whether it was in the pub that we were practicing, whether it was, you know, in private life of going through our like first relationships and stuff.
I think also like, just like the pure act of like, I don't think, apart from the other guitarist and the drummer, like, I don't think me, Steen or Josh were like that musically like well versed in like terms of like modern kind of guitar music. So I think especially like you can kind of hear it as the album goes along, like, you know, we've discovered bands we hadn't listened to before, like The Fall and The Stooges and Television, and I feel like that kind of, you know, over those 3 years kind of, you know, we kind of, there'd be a period where we wanted to sound like that and then like this, and I think that's why it ended up being quite eclectic, you know. But it's good.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Guys, you've been really good sports. I appreciate it. Put up with my nonsense and stuttering. But we always like to ask words of wisdom from our guests.
My candle burns at both ends. It will not last a night. But R, my foes, and E, my friends, it gives such a lovely light. That's Roald Dahl's motto that he lived by. And I always remember that from his book Kid, which is his autobiography. Just let go. Just let go.
Thank you so much for watching, and please subscribe.
And if you're really feeling it, please hit us up on Patreon. Cheers.